Thanks everybody for coming. My name is Nick Young. I'm the sustainability manager here at Hopworks. And I was really excited when I learned that the B Corp Summit was going to be in Portland and that some of our fellow B Corp certified brewers were going to be here in person. And I jumped at the opportunity to get a bunch of people in a room to talk about what sustainability in brewing looks like. So joining me today on the far end is Chris from Brewery Vivant, and I'll ask you all to introduce yourself with a little more detail here in a moment. Then Steve from Beau's All Natural, Katie from New Belgium, and you all may know Christian from Hopworks here.
Hello. Welcome.
Welcome, yeah, absolutely. This is a pretty thrilling opportunity to talk, like I said, about sustainability and brewing with B Corp as the centerpiece. So why don't we just start off, Chris, if you want to introduce yourself, tell us a little bit about what things are like at Brewery Vivant.
Yeah, so Brewery Vivant's in Grand Rapids, Michigan. We're about a 5,000 barrel brewery right now. We can our beer, distribute it to Michigan, Chicagoland, and Indiana with an occasional random ship somewhere else. But we've been a B Corp for a year and a half, so in next May we will recertify. We're working on that process already. We also are, our brewery is the first LEED certified commercial microbrewery that we know of, which is kind of exciting. They will not give us that title because they don't track breweries through
that
the
we know
Green
of,
Building
like
Council.
That.
But, yeah, so we're Belgian and French inspired beer, I should mention that too.
Steve, my dad and I started Beau's All Natural Brewing Company in 2006. We decided to bring the whole family along for the ride, so my sister's hanging out over there. Everyone in the family works for the brewery, except for my mom, who's now retired from the brewery. We've also hired all of our unemployable friends. We've made it very much a friends and family company. All of our beers are certified organic. We've been a B Corp now for just about 2 years. We're just going through the recertification process. We have a lot of fun. We've grown from pretty much as small a brewery as you could possibly have to a decent sized regional brewery. We're going to make around 40,000 barrels of beer this year, and we've got about 150 staff, so we just keep having more fun with it.
So I'm Katie, I work at New Belgium, and my job is in sustainability. And I've been there for about 11 years. We are going on our third year of certification. So we just recertified this last winter. And I think for us, you know, we're employee owned. We've been a values-based business for a very long time, since our beginning 24 years ago. And the B Corp certification really helped to put into words what we've been doing for the entire lifespan of our brewery. And so excited to talk more about that as we go along.
My name is Christian Ettinger. My business partner and wife, Brandy, is over there. The two of us started Hopworks about 7 years ago with the goal of taking world-class beer and a brew pub in a more sustainable direction. So we started out with about 43 employees when we opened, and now we've got 132 wonderful coworkers and a great trajectory. We describe sustainability as construction and operation, and as it relates to operation, the B Corp has really kind of inverted the way we talk about our business. We used to talk all about organics and green building, and now B Corp's at the top of the list. So really excited to, it's highlighted a lot of wonderful things for us in terms of successes, but also opportunities. So
great, thanks everybody, and welcome. Super glad to get this thing rolling. So first question, I'm just gonna start really broadly. Steve, can you talk a little bit about why sustainability makes sense in a brewery? Why you put that into the core of Beau's from the beginning?
Yeah, well, I guess the basic premise is it's better to be at the leading edge than the trailing edge of anything. I firmly believe that beer is more than just the liquid. It's the entire experience. It's the belief you have in it. And I always like to say that, you know, beer tastes better when you can feel good drinking it. And when we started the brewery, kind of realized that we only have one chance to start off on the right foot. So it was really important that we build sustainability into the DNA of the brewery right from the get-go, as opposed to sort of trying to get the brewery up and running and then try to build it in afterwards on the back end, because figure it's so much easier to sort of build it to start with than it is to try to retrofit afterwards.
Absolutely. Christian, same question. Anything to add about why sustainability made sense for you as you started up the brewery?
Yeah, I mean, certainly in retrospect, it's been a great point of differentiation, but it's really the most meaningful way you can approach business. Breweries are inherently very resource intensive on the input side, from fuel to water to electricity. You know, we use a lot of resources, so who better to lead by example than a brewery? And so, but oddly enough, there were also some wonderful aspects, organics as well in terms of sourcing, but the marketing ability of sustainable brewing is never to be overlooked. So I like the marriage of this really meaningful engagement, thoughtful approach to business, and it was also something that differentiated us.
Super. Chris or Katie, anything you want to add? Or
there's this idea sometimes that sustainability doesn't make business sense, or that it's more expensive, and in a lot of cases that's true. But in most cases, we're seeing we're actually more profitable because of our social and environmental efforts, and not in spite of them. And so there are all kinds of little things, like, for example, we make money on our waste program because we divide the streams of waste and sell them for a revenue. And then we were just at New Seasons Market today touring around, and they actually switched all of their sampling cups to reusables instead of disposables, and they found when they started doing the research that was actually cheaper than using disposables. And so I think that there are these ideas perhaps that sustainability is more expensive, but one of the reasons that we do it is because we know it's good for business as well.
Yeah, I'll just add one comment. So sustainability is something that's been important to my husband Jason and I, who own it, personally, so we wanted to bring that value into the business. But I think it's cool, and this somewhat echoes what's already been said, but our industry is so in the forefront of people's faces, and people are excited about it, and it's a really easy way to engage consumers in terms of, you know, treating the earth with respect and each other, and making sure that we're not just focusing on our capitalism that, you know, this country's built on. So I think as a brewery, we have like this great time right now, right, to take advantage of this huge spotlight on us and advocate for this business model, as I think we can reach a lot of customers and other businesses that way.
I like that, echoing that, bringing as much personal passion and meaning to the business is it really resonates, because that thoughtful, meaningful approach to living, you engage that in the business, and people really, it really resonates with not only your staff, but also the public as well. So it really creates a tight-knit bond.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the business case is there, and we'll actually come back to that a little bit in a minute, but it's the right thing to do. We all know that. It's nice to be able to use our bully pulpit of creating a discretionary product and talk about that. So Katie, I'll start with you, but most companies can't afford a sustainability manager, let alone several of them or a stable of them. What would you say are a handful of things that small breweries could do to start off with a sustainability program?
Yeah, we actually didn't have a sustainability person for the first 15 years or so that we were in business. And I think that what helped us to maintain this area as a key focus was the fact that we had founders that were really passionate about it and wove it into their decision making and their the language that they used. And then also they empowered our coworkers to work on projects themselves, and it really, you know, it is specifically called out in our core values and beliefs. And then we also, in addition to that, you know, speak about it in meetings. It's not just sitting on a piece of paper, but it's something that when we're doing projects, we're talking about not the financial benefit only, but also, and the quality of the beer, of course, but also what are the sustainability aspects? How does this affect people? How does this affect the environment? And I don't think that happens in every conversation consistently, but the fact that every one of our coworkers feels like they're a champion of that, or has permission to be a champion of that, really helps to make that a reality. And then we also did a process. We formalized our sustainability goals. So we had a consultant come in and worked with 17 people across the brewery, and they we asked ourselves the questions like, what are the issues facing the planet today? How does the brewing industry contribute to those issues? And then how can we as New Belgium start to turn that around a little bit? And so we actually set formal goals, and that's really, I think, when we started getting a ton of momentum around it, is when we actually had these goals and we were tracking them and showing our progress in front of everybody, and we were publishing it to the public, and that really helped us to stay accountable for it when you know, things get busy with growth and all kinds of stuff. So yeah, having goals and then empowering people within the brewery to work towards those.
Sure. And from the other end of the spectrum in regards to size, Chris, what do you think about, without having somebody devoted to that full time, what does sustainability program look like for a small brewer?
Yeah, for us, it's really pretty similar. So we start out with the goals. So that was my business background before we started Vivant 5 years ago. But so I knew going into it, if you have goals and you're measuring your progress towards them and you're reporting on them, and we do an annual sustainability report too, you do force yourself to stay accountable. The other thing that was great with that, so we created that structure from the beginning. And then from the first person we hired, part of the hiring process was talking about what does sustainability mean for Vivant. They go through a training that's just 1 hour sitting down with me, but we have that conversation. Here's what it looks like, and here's what your role can do to impact our sustainability goals. And then for everybody's performance reviews, which we do once a year, we actually have sustainability on there, so they're graded, so to speak, on four aspects, and that's one of them for all the hourly staff, as well as the salaried staff ends up with some more detailed information put within there. But we've built it within the company, which I think that structure is really important in moving things forward. But then the other side of that is, as you're having these conversations, you can see where people's passions lie, right? So when we hire someone new, like, maybe they came to us because they know we're focused on this, maybe not, but they're really excited about, you know, social equity or the environment or something. And we give them the opportunity to, you know, take that passion and do something with it. So, you know, it does become everybody's job, but certain people kind of latch on and they're willing to do more, and then that just becomes part of what they do. So we have our ops manager ends up focusing on our waste program too, and our guy that has our garden does this education about kids and where their food comes from in schools, and we give them you know, the ability to put that passion to work, and I think that helps to just keep that culture snowballing. And they hold each other accountable too, which I love. We have this guy TJ that's all about it, and if you see someone put something recyclable in the trash, he goes and takes it out and he tells them, like, no, this is not where it should go, this is where it should go. So they hold each other accountable too. So all those little things, you know, definitely add up and have created a pretty strong culture.
Gentlemen, Steve or Christian, anything to add with regards to sustainability for the small brewer?
Yeah, I think the main thing is not to let yourself get overwhelmed. When we started off, you know, we were like, well, we can't do that cool thing that New Belgium's doing, or we can't afford to do that thing. And at first it was overwhelming and disappointing. We're like, oh, you know, there's other people doing way more than we're able to do. And then we just kind of stopped and said, okay, we're this size, what can we actually work on? And small things like our purchasing policy. Hey, you know what, we can choose to buy post-consumer recycled paper as opposed to virgin paper. That's something. And finding just the things that we could focus on that we could actually achieve, and still with the mind of, we want to get to that place. We want to be the, you know, the absolute pinnacle of sustainability, but we can't do it all overnight, because it would kill us. So kind of keeping it kind of within reason and not letting ourselves get overwhelmed by the things that we couldn't achieve in day one was really important for us.
We still struggle with that too.
I'm sure. There's a lot of great resources out there to help kind of get through that quagmire. It's easy to get overwhelmed, absolutely. And you know, just starting small, starting with your envelope and your shell, you know, start with your space and look at, you know, easy ways to green up the environment, your constructed and built environment, and then it all comes back to inputs and outputs. So yeah, don't get overwhelmed. And there's a DIY way to approach all these challenges. And I think just having a few key people in each department who are just genuinely excited about it is a great way to start. You don't have to hire a position. It took us many years to find Nate and find the budget for that. It's awesome now, but it used to just be, you know, just having thoughtful people engage in each department.
It's kind of a self-serving question, isn't it, Nate?
Not on purpose. You know, the other thing I would point out is there's a lot of resources available. Energy Trust of Oregon here in the Pacific Northwest is really great. They'll do all of the sort of energy assessment if you're looking for new equipment or that sort of stuff. And I'm sure almost anywhere in the country and the world, there's organizations out there that would love to bring some chutzpah to whatever sort of system or program you're looking to put into place.
On a technical side, the Brewers Association has manuals for free online. So water, waste, and energy are the current manuals. There's one coming up for green building and also wastewater. So, from a technical perspective, there's definitely lots of brewery resources.
Don't have to start from scratch.
Yeah.
Hey, one more thing to add, too. We've been really good at using interns from the local colleges by us. There's a few sustainable programs, and, you know, there's plenty other ones. But because our industry is awesome, people want to be a part of it, and we've paid them in beer, and they've loved it. So we've had really good success with hosting an internship that has a focus, whether it's like, hey, look at our waste stream and tell us how we can improve it, to doing a carbon footprint of our beer and other things in between. That's how we came out with our sustainability report, was actually interns trying to help us think through how do we put that message out there. So I think sometimes people shy away from interns, but definitely never shy away from interns, because they're excited and you know, interview them, you can see it. And they're a really pretty cheap resource. And you build their resume, right? So you're like creating this great opportunity for your business and for them.
They do, there's like at Yale at least, and I think some other schools as well, they have an intern stipend program for interns that work at nonprofits and also interns that work at B Corp. So we've had interns from there, and it's an amazing thing, like, to be able to share that expense and make it more affordable.
Yeah, that's great. So Chris, you touched on this a little bit, but maybe from your perspective, Steve, at Beau's, how do you guys go about engaging your employees to follow the path that you're trying to set forth?
Well, beer is a very powerful motivator. like the other panelists have said, setting goals, both department-based and company-based and individually, goes a long way. But there's kind of the cultural side of it too, and I find what really works for us is when our employees get to see very directly what the results of the efforts do. For example, we started a home delivery program run by it's not a homeless youth shelter, but their mission is to prevent homeless youth from becoming homeless adults. So lots of education, health services. But then also we created a delivery service program where you buy your beer online. They literally hire homeless youth to sort the beer, bring it out, deliver it. So they get actual jobs, they get paid, and then they get to build their resumes. We've had some great success stories with that, where, you know, someone that was homeless is now full-time university. Another one that's, you know, full-time working. Several people that have gotten off the street through this. Well, the Operation Come Home that has this program with us, they do a graduation every year for the youth that have made it, you know, through secondary school, or, you know, even for ones that just got a couple credits that year. We try to bring as many employees as we can down to that, and I would be willing to bet that there's about a 95% ratio of people that have gone and cried when they've been there. And it's when you can kind of have that personal connection. I find, because we're a packaging brewery, so most of the stuff that we do is kind of one step removed. You know, it's happening, the customer's interaction is with the pub or with the bottle shop. And so having our staff kind of getting to actually face the end customer, and not just the end customer, but the person that's been really directly affected by some of the good works that we've done, tends to really go a long way. And it's whether it's, you know, you supported that fundraiser I was doing for this thing, or, you know, you helped me get off the street. Those kind of interactions are so meaningful for the staff, and it becomes storytelling at that point. And storytelling is huge for culture. And it becomes that thing that, you know, this one thing then ripples for decades afterwards.
That's great. How about from your perspective, Katie, anything that New Belgium does, super proud of, that engages folks from the ground up?
Yeah, I think, well, we're 100% employee owned, so I think we really work on cultivating this ownership mentality, and the fact that we all have ownership in the company, it certainly helps us to feel more responsible for things outside of our job descriptions, you know, and taking care of the business as a whole. So that I think that in that sense, we're starting with a little a foot up, I guess, in engaging people in the value side of the business. But we also work in beer, and I think inherently everyone that comes to work for us is very human and very, you know, has big hearts really, and really interested in helping, and whether it be helping the environment or helping their coworkers. We have a group of coworkers that actually started a coworker assistance fund for people going through hard times, and you know, all of us donate to it. I think 80% of coworkers or something donate to that fund, and so throughout the brewery, I think people inherently are really excited to get involved as long as we provide those opportunities for it. And in the beginning, you know, we had like a green team kind of, and we called it the Sustainabilities, and that group named itself, and it was a group of people who cared a lot about this and wanted to make sure that we were furthering it in the organization. But then, you know, throughout, you know, you get busy brewing a beer, or this batch, you know, needs a little extra help, or we're a little bit behind on the filler, and there are things going on that we would have a lot of ideas, but they wouldn't really come to fruition a lot of times because they weren't built into people's jobs, and then also ultimately people weren't accountable for it. You know, you were mentioning in your reviews that there's a piece on sustainability, and I think that's we really have had the most success since then, where we really, you know, I went around to every group, so like all the brewers and I met, and then the packagers and I met, and accounting, met with accounting, and had individual conversations about our values and about sustainability as it relates to their daily work. So we made the conversation really personal and a part of their job. And so since then, I think we've seen a lot more engagement in that sense, because it's now a personal thing. Like they always cared about it, and now there's a way, you know, that they can relate, that my coworkers can relate to the topic and engage with it, that's very specific to their job, and it's not like this extra thing that they do on the side. So for example, one of my coworkers, Jesse, I keep looking over to Jamie, because Jamie's here from New Belgium. He's been, 21 years?
Yeah.
20, yeah.
Give or take.
Yeah. He's our local Portland guy, and been in the brewery for a long time. But Jesse Shear, who's you know, huge fan of our triple, the mascot for triple beer at New Belgium. She works in the warehouse, and she was actually getting involved in this stuff a little, and she saw that like some of the marketing stuff we were getting in was all wrapped in plastic bags, and she was like, that's not very sustainable and not very like, you know, New Belgium-y. And so she had the idea to just call up the supplier and have them not pack it in plastic bags. And so like literally 5 minutes after into that phone call, we had eliminated plastic bags on all of the stuff. And so that's just all of our coworkers. I think inherently most humans want to work on it. It's just like, do I have time? Do I have permission? Am I going to get credit for this as a part of my job, perhaps? And making it personal.
I love that. Just give people permission to do the right thing, and they're going to jump at the chance.
Yeah. Yeah.
Christian or Chris, anything you might add about engaging employees?
Yeah, I think, you know, one of our gating items when we're interviewing folks is we ask them, you know, what do you do sustainability-wise at home, you know, personal practice. And it's not that we wouldn't hire them if they weren't doing anything, but it really just forces the thought immediately, like at the doorstep, as you're coming into our four walls. This is really important to us. And more recently, we've not only surrounded ourselves with very thoughtful people, but we started inserting sustainability into the job description, the key objectives. So it creates a bit of a framework and objective, so you know if you're winning or losing sustainably. And that's just kind of going live right now. It took us 7 years to get there. So either we're really slow or it's kind of a new novel way of approaching a job description. But now they're bonused on their degree to which they succeed sustainably in their own departments. So you can get geeky on it like that. But I think it just really starts by setting that very organic, forget that word, natural stage as a gating item. When you come into this building, it's just expected that you're going to do the right thing no matter who's watching, you know?
I would say, just one more thing to add, that if it's not fun, it's not sustainable. And so, like, we have to, like, if sustainability is about policing people and guilting them and shaming them, then it becomes like a chore. And I think that then we're less likely to do it when no one's looking. And so, one thing, you know, beer is fun. And if we're not in alignment with that in our sustainability efforts, then it's probably a little more challenging.
I have used guilt and shame, though. I mean, when we do our report every year, I make everybody read it, and they have to send me an email that says, like, either what three things did you learn that you didn't know that Vivant was doing, or what things could you do differently, you know, based on seeing where we're falling short of our goals or whatever. So it forces engagement. It is totally an assignment that they have to do, but I think it makes them like step back and absorb the information where they may have like taken it for granted that, oh, this is just what we do and I'm not sure exactly what this means, but and we get so many great ideas. I think that's one of the things I learned in this last year is by forcing that assignment on people, like they have awesome ideas, and unless you're asking them, like they're not compelled to tell us, even though I don't understand why, because I feel like we're always asking staff to, like, you know, tell us what could we be doing better, but like making them actually spend that time, we implemented like 12 things like that made a difference. So that was cool for them too, to see like their ideas were being used. You would think they would keep streaming in, but they're not. So next March, when they are forced to read that report again,
book we'll reports for everybody.
We actually, like on the slide, for people who are doing just an amazing job like championing this, because we say like, we tell people every orientation when you come in, like everybody works in sustainability. We're just here to make sure that that fire is stoked, but like you guys are the fuel. And so we, for some people who just have done amazing work in this realm, we slide them like a nice bottle of like Colorado whiskey, and that the word's gotten out about that. And so like you'll have like people every once in a while, like, you know, kind of like mention it under their breath or something, like, oh, that's, you're showing up because for the whiskey.
Fishing.
Right, yeah.
I love it. So I'm gonna take a little break. We're not done yet, but if so far there's any audience questions, if we've prompted anything you're dying to know or ask the panel up to this point yet. Has anybody got any anything they would love to ask? Yeah, so anybody hear from others or take the opportunity proactively to go talk about sustainability with breweries
and,
around you?
And kind of B Corp?
Absolutely.
So we've done panels before on becoming a B Corp to the Craft Brewers Conference. I've spoken at the Master Brewers technical annual meeting about becoming a brewery. I've spoken at the Ontario Craft Brewers Conference about being a B Corp, as well as other sustainability initiatives we've done. So I've done a lot of public speaking on it, and then typically what happens is after one of those sessions, there's, you know, a handful of breweries that are a bit more serious than the other ones, and they'll follow up and they've got lots of great questions. And I do spend a fair bit of my time after giving, you know, one of the talks on sort of, well, what about this and how about that, and I think there's been some really good spin-off in our local area. There's one other brewery that I know of that has gone out and hired a sustainability coordinator to help them after hearing some of the stuff that we were doing, and it's catching on, and I think it's important work to do. It's a little bit evangelical at times, it feels, but that's okay, you know.
Yeah, where's the fine line between evangelical and being a zealot, right?
Yeah.
When you turn into an asshole.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah. Good call.
Let's be honest.
Yeah, I think we get asked, I don't know, I would say like maybe 12, 15 times a year you know, breweries calling up and saying that they're considering certification, and what was it like? What does it really look like at the end once you have the certification? How hard is it to get approval or to go through the process? And so we actually get asked by a lot of companies, but we'll always talk to a brewery about it. We don't always have time to do it every time, but we love to see this movement growing within breweries, because I think that breweries are such naturals for B Corp certification. Like we live in our communities, you know, like we're making things with our hands, and it seems to me like, and the whole culture of the craft brewing industry in general is just very familial and collaborative, and we share a lot of process tips with each other. Unlike most industries, I think we're very open booked with one another, and I think that it's kind of a natural thing that we would move in this direction, because we are so community based and already, you know, have some of the core values that B Corp champions. So the B Corp is just like a way to unite under one battle cry and to receive more resources, but these are things that I think breweries have been doing for a long time.
The mentoring, it's our duty, right, to, you know, kind of, I guess, leaders or innovators in this realm to have an open book and open source and really welcome that dialogue. We've helped brewers kind of negotiate organic certification, and you know, Katie and I are on the sustainability subcommittee for the Brewers Association, so that's another great way of contributing and helping to share this information in a larger setting, a national setting, and you know, speaking at the CBC or MBA, I've done that as well, and it's all about sharing, and this kind of rising tide raises all boats. So I think that's a beautiful part about sustainability. Although it's a point of differentiation, it's one that you hope everybody assumes as part of their business plan going forward. So yeah, really, we get approached, but we also approach too. It's important to kind of engage people actively and also be there to pick up the phone.
Yeah, if you're the only one that's successful in sustainability, you're not really successful, right? It takes all of us.
I just add, so in Michigan, you know, we have our Michigan Brewers Guild, which is a really good guild. It's awesome that our state has such a strong one. So we, along with some other sustainably minded breweries, we're talking and we're like, you know, we should, like the BA has the subcommittee, we should do a subcommittee through our own guild in Michigan. So we're now meeting, you know, via phone once a month, but quarterly having one of these breweries host the other breweries to come in that want to learn about whatever best practice that brewery wants to share. And we'll invite consultants that can help or government people that can help. So we're just starting that process. Actually, our first quarterly meeting is Thursday, so I'm going to miss it, but for a good reason. But we're excited to see, you know, as just the state's brewers, how can we get that message out there and help get the other breweries kind of moving along further if they want to be moving along further. And I think we even secured a time slot at our winter conference with the guild to be able to talk about what is sustainability, like what's that committee doing, but also what is the B Corp and what are some things you can do. So we've done the start of that outreach, and I think we based that sort of on what Colorado does, right? You guys have a good sharing network program like that. The opportunities we see that are more low-hanging fruit are the supply side. So we do a supplier assessment right now, but we don't do much more with that. So we want to like drive that further. You know, even though we're small, it's easy for us to feel like no one's going to listen to what we're saying as far as the big brewery suppliers. But that doesn't mean we can't start talking to our local supply chain more and trying to talk more about sustainability and those values that we have, and how can we help you set up a program. So that's one area we're looking at. The other thing, I think, you know, if you look at B Corp and the structure, you've got, you know, like where we are, we're on the lower end of the B Corp point scale, that where you have to be, right? You have to have 80 points to be certified, and we were at, I think, 86, which means like we're doing good things and it was great, but we want to get up like past 100 into that point where you're not just doing good things as a business, but you truly are impacting change, right? So doing the using business as a force for good. So we're trying to come up with programs, kind of like what Steve was mentioning with like using these homeless teens to like drive, you know, a career path for them. We're looking at that next level as a business, and where within our business model would those types of relationships work, and who else could we partner with. That's like super exciting, and I'm really happy to be here.
FYI,
for this
we didn't
retreat.
Get any points for that home delivery.
You don't, but I think. But we don't want to chase points. But like, and those things can lead to other things.
But I think it's a great question because.
I just want to repeat the question.
Oh,
the question
sure.
was now that we're B Corp certified, how are we looking to use that certification to sort of move forward and continue to get better? And this is also a good segue. My next question was going to be, how does B Corp certification really fit into that broader sustainability program? So, sorry.
Yeah, so it's a great question because for me, I think that that is the most impactful part of being a B Corp is you've got now just a 200 question list of anything you could possibly think of to make your company better. And so what we did is after getting our assessment score, the first time we did it, we did it blind. We didn't sort of do a practice run and then do it. We just said, let's find out if we're certifiable. We knew we were. and then afterwards, it was a matter of, we went back through the entire thing and we sat there with someone from every single part of the company and said, we're gonna break this up into sections. And so this section deals with purchasing. So it's gonna go to the purchasing manager and here's everything that relates to purchasing that we scored poorly on. Here's your goal for the next 2 years is to work on these. And then for the marketing team, the sales team, administrative team, and we've really just broken up all of that. And what I find for us, it's hard for us to get kind of a true understanding of what marketing impact or sales impact or what lift we're getting from being a B Corp. What we see as the real value for us is that questionnaire, that scorecard, because it really, it's helped us determine a path. And there's, we were talking about being overwhelmed earlier, and there's so many things you can do. And once you sort of get known in the community as being a forward-thinking business, everyone with a good idea comes out of the woodwork. And it's really hard to sit there and evaluate what's, you know, is a spend on this better than a spend in this, and you know, what's really the best way to focus the resources. Well, having this scorecard, it now helps us kind of determine where we want to invest in, because it's okay, well, this is you know, something we can achieve and it's measurable. And that's a big thing, is it allows you to measure your ability to improve over a time period. And, you know, anyone that's, you know, sort of running a business or in business has some amount of competitiveness to them. And what I like about this is you're really competing against how you did last time, you know. So you're not competing against other companies, you're competing against yourself. And that brings out the best, I think, in the team.
We've had journalists that have looked at the scores of the breweries and wanted to compare us, and I'm like, please don't do that, because look at these are the people who are really, like, everybody here is working very hard, and using the scores, you know, for yourself is really like the main thing. And but yeah, I think and really it's hard to compare because we don't get the same set of questions, every one of us. So depending on, you know, where you, what size you are, what kind of business you are, it's a slightly different set of questions, and so it's hard to compare apples to apples, essentially.
It's highlighted some great opportunities for us. So I think we got 95.8 points or something like that. So basically, I told myself when we get to 200, I can retire. So the quicker I get there, it could be a year, it could be 20 years, you know, but the job's done at that point. No. Yeah, no, but it's really, I think if we reassess right now, we'd probably be closer to 100. And really, like, board of directors, for instance, is one of our key objectives, because it not only came from, it was highlighted by the B Corp application, but it was also highlighted by our bank. And you begin to see that, wow, okay, so best in class needs these things, the basic tenets for successful operations. And that's all B Corp, just basically giving you a really great measure of best in class performance. So yeah, we're gonna have our first board of directors meeting ever next month, and that's a really cool thing for us. And it came to us from B Corp and our bank, and we'll be better off for it. And then there's hopefully we had 110 points by the end of the year, and we're really super jazzed about that. You know?
I think that's like the cool thing about B Corp is different. There are a lot of nonprofits that are looking at certifying companies that are doing good and different things like organic and everything else. But the thing that I think is so that differentiates B Corp from the rest of them is that the guys that started it, the three founders, they all have a very strong background in business. And so the assessment is really understanding what a business needs to survive. So it's not only like, how can you be best for the world, but you got to keep yourself afloat, and these are some of the best practices as a business. And so there's a lot of like business sense baked into this because they really are truly, you know, looking at how we merge these worlds. It's not just doing good, it's about doing good in, as a business. And so I think that like the things that they ask of us and the resources they provide are all very astute, you know, it makes sense that they're not asking too much oftentimes, and the resources are helpful for our business overall.
Great segue, Katie. My next question is really about that business case. So can you wrap a little bit more about, you know, the sort of, if I were to ask a business person that hasn't jumped into sustainability first, what they think about sustainability, the first response is very often, well, that's expensive and I can't afford it. So can you respond a little bit to, and you talked a little bit about this earlier, but you know, why, what's the business case and how do you make it? How do you send it up the chain, for instance, if you find a new initiative that maybe has a cost? What's the business case?
Well, I think that no matter your size, there are, like, you can do things at Bose that we can't do at New Belgium. We can do things that you can't do, like, because you have more, you're more flexible maybe at a certain size. There's always, you know, different levels of resources that we're all working with. And so I think that there are different opportunities depending on the size of the brewery and the resources on staff and you know, and in the bank. And so, but I think that probably one of the things that's helped us the most is just taking a long-term approach to paybacks. And I think a lot of people look at, you know, wanting to get a payback on something within 2 years or 18 months or something like that. And I think with us, we've just said, this is the right thing to do right now. And if you look at the incremental cost, we can afford it. It's not putting our business at risk by doing this. Maybe it's more expensive than the other, and maybe it has a 5-year payback. But those decisions that we made 15 years ago that have 5-year payback, they're all, the savings of those are accumulating over the years. And so I think taking that longer term approach sometimes is what's required to see some of the payback on these sustainability investments. Investing in people, is really, you know, and so we talk about sustainability, and sometimes that's environmental, sometimes it's social, sometimes it's a little bit of both, you know, but under the B Corp lens, and I think that's really what it's offered us, is this like ability to merge all of those into one conversation, because they are truly related. Because people who are happy and well are more creative, and they have access to higher functioning parts of their brain. And so it's, those are really indirect things. It's hard to do a payback analysis or an ROI on like how, you know, the fact that we help this person feel like they belong, and that we allow them to go leave to go take their kid to the doctor when they're sick. You know, these things about just being human in the workplace and investing in your people. You know, those are hard to see the payback on those, but that's, we know that that stuff is paid back in the long term. Every single person at New Belgium in your first year, you take a communications class. So just kind of like giving people tools to get through this work. I think that those investments in people, one, help us to save money throughout the organization, but help us to be more sustainable. And there's not always a direct payback, but sometimes you just have to use your gut or your heart and just say that I can afford this, and I know it's a good thing, and so we're gonna trust that it's gonna pay back over time. And a little mixture of art and science, I guess, in that one.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's interesting to think of the value of an engaged employee. An HR professional is gonna tell you it's infinite. Mm-hmm. So maybe there's not a specific dollar value, but they're gonna stick around for a little while, and that's in itself something beneficial. Yeah. Christian, sorry, Katie.
Amen.
Anything else you would add, Christian?
I know, there's like, yeah, it's this alchemy, right? It's this wonderful mix of art and science. The science is the pro forma that you can build around some of these capital expenditures, and then the art is the art of communication and really raising that bar and expectation for your employees. So I think you really have to have a great skeleton for pro forma to make sure you're not going to bury yourself in unreasonable debt to get to some, you know, kind of utopian vision of what sustainability means in terms of hardware. So there, you can quantify it, but then there is this the heart and soul. The reason why we all do this was probably built outside of pro forma, just honestly trying to do the right thing every day. So I like that, the juxtaposition, but I still find myself leaning more and more on pro formas every year, you know, so for the big expenses, because they're the ones that can kind of tip you the wrong way. Like our B Corp machine, I call it, is when we put a CIP skid in, that's what gave us enough points to get certified. So it was very much about a $13,000 piece of equipment with a very short payback that really started us down this journey, down this road. So I can say that the pro forma was a great way to engage sustainability and with that short payback. Jump on anything inside of 12 months payback, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah. Well, a couple thoughts. The first is that the triple bottom line of sustainability includes profit. And so anyone that looks at sustainability as just lowering carbon footprint is taking too narrow a view of this. Sustainability needs to start with keeping the lights on, and it needs to keep your people happy. And a lot of this is hard to measure in the short term, but it's you start to see patterns develop over time. So for us, I think in our 9-year history, there's been 1 year where we grew less than 40%. And that was, we hit 38% that year. What's interesting is it's actually scaling up. As we get bigger, that growth rate's actually increasing, not decreasing. We're in the middle of nowhere. We're located in a town of 1,800 people and 2,000 cows. It used to be impossible to get someone to locate at the brewery and take a job with us. And, you know, we'd have to fight for someone. Now we post up, you know, that we've got a position opening, and there's hundreds and hundreds of applicants. And if we were just a good brewery, don't get me wrong, it's difficult enough to be a good brewery. But if we were just a good brewery, we wouldn't attract people, because there's lots of great breweries out there. I think it really is the fact that we've self-identified as a brewery that's, you know, interested in our people, the community, and fun, that's driving people to us. And to me, the sustainability is not the extra expense that we bear, you know, and that's we're successful despite it. To me, that's a big part of why we're successful, and why we're more successful than any other brewery in our, you know, in our area, whatever you, space, what thing.
Yeah, so the question is, how does the community aspect of B Corp certification fit in? Are you driving volunteerism or anything along those lines?
we have 15 goals that are sustainability related, and one of them is we've had it as 10% of our profits to local charities. We're switching to 1% of sales because it's way easier to track. So we have that in place. So we have a budget that is my job to dole out, and I love that part of my job. And the way we've done the financial side of it, or, you know, product in kind, is looking at, you know, what are the personal things we're passionate about, as well as what are the natural ways that our business, you know, can help the community. So one of our biggest things we're doing this year is there's a program that's fantastic in our city where someone, as principal, realized that, you know, they feed kids breakfast and lunch at school, and you just assume a kid goes home and has dinner, and she saw like a 10-year-old girl digging through the school's trash. And it was just like, you know, hey, what's going on? How can I help? And, well, my family doesn't eat at night because we don't have any food. So this, like, bolt of lightning struck her, and she now created this organization that's, like, 10 years old. So they deliver sack suppers to the schools to have the kids bring them home so they actually have a meal, because it does help to learn when you're not hungry. So we look at that. We have a school that's like literally across the street from us, and we figured out that we can afford within our giving budget to sponsor all the meals that go to the kids in our neighborhood. And for us, like, we're a high-end brewery and restaurant. Like, we're not, a lot of our neighbors come. We're a really cool mixed neighborhood as far as who makes it up, but it's not accessible to all of our neighbors, and like, that makes us feel like we're at least impacting those around us who are never going to step in our doors. So we try to find those alignments that make a lot of sense and make a big impact. And then we have another goal that's focused on volunteer time. So right now we do, if you're hourly, we'll pay you 4 hours of volunteer time a year. And if you're a tipped employee, we pay you the living wage, which is what we pay as a minimum wage. And offer all these different events that people can do. And we've had, successes and not successes there. We're trying to revamp, like, how do we get more people going? That's an interesting employee engagement piece where everyone is, like, super fired up that they work for this great company. And, on the dollar side, our turnover is less and our employees are engaged and our customers notice that and it's awesome. But then they're still not willing to take that extra time, even if we're paying them, to do these volunteer events. So I think this year we're focusing on, our biggest six partners that we'll support in a more public way. We're going to attach a charity or a volunteering event to that and try to get more staff out that way. So we looked at a goal of 200 volunteer hours. And the salaried people were really, loose about it, as they're not tracking their time, and they are really excited, and they end up spending more time, volunteering than the 4 hours, but that's awesome. They still are getting their work done. And then what I mentioned before, trying to, create those programs where we can employ people that are traditionally unemployable and help. There's some really cool, welfare to career paths that Grand Rapids has kind of outlined through some other really amazing businesses that are also certified B Corps. So we're trying to plug into some of those existing structures in a way that works for the business that we have and for their programs. So those are the things I get most excited about. I can keep going.
Yeah, it's funny. We scored lowest on the community section out of all the sections in the actual B Corp scorecard. And I think mainly because a lot of those questions are geared towards organizations that are directly producing something for the, disenfranchised or medical supplies and things like that. So it's hard to score high in that section as a brewery, we found. But we do a lot. We hold a signature fundraiser every year. We actually just completed it last weekend. It's an Oktoberfest themed event, but we're up to about $100,000 a year we raise for charity at that event. We're now, I think the total is $440,000 over the last several years that event alone has raised. In any given year, we'll support more than 100 different charities, Our 7-year total for that is now over $1 million. We do as much as we can in that realm. We've always shied away from doing the percent of profit because there's been years where the profit's not been very high. It would be very depressing.
We didn't like to fudge profit a lot. What should our profit have been? That's the number we're
going to
target.
What we try to do is, again, we look at how much we did last year and we try to beat it the next year. As far as our employee engagement goes, we do encourage them to support the events that we're supporting to start with, but then we also allow them to do other volunteerism. And we also will quite often we'll do sort of in-house fundraising for local support, where we'll do a potluck lunch, and then everyone pays for the potluck lunch, and that goes to donate money. Then we'll do a 50-50 draw on top of that, just within the employees. And so for unregistered charities, but let's say there's a family who's had one of their children needs some medical attention. Well, within a week we can raise $1,000 for them, and we do that very regularly, and we've really sort of, that's, it's another way we've been able to engage our employees into this spirit of giving. Is quite often it's the employees will come to us and say, hey, this has happened, I'd really like to do a fundraiser for, you know, this family or for this thing that's happened. And so we say, yeah, and then on the brewery's end, whatever gets raised, we match. So it kind of gives that much more incentive for the employees to kind of take it on their own initiative to support these things.
So, I mean, similar programs. So we actually are also certified by 1% for the Planet. So we donate 1% of our revenue to nonprofits and that have kind of an environmental focus. That's the agreement with 1%. And so our categories, we several years ago really like tried to target like what systems are supporting our livelihood and how can we give back to those. So water stewardship is one of our grant categories, sustainable agriculture. We do use environmental education just because we feel like, and, you know, inspiring youth at an early age is worthwhile. And then bicycle advocacy for us is relevant with, you know, fat tire and the bike. And so we try to, you know, really strategically put money back into the places that we benefit from. So to make that more of a full circle relationship with our resources. And then we also, for volunteer time, we give our coworkers 1 hour of vacation time for every 2 hours they volunteer. So, and
is there a limit to that?
There is, yeah. I don't know that anyone's ever hit it, but yeah.
2,000 hours off.
Right? Yeah, I mean, it's a high limit, but maybe a week.
Is it in addition to their normal vacation time?
Yeah, like so it just adds, vacation? It's bonus vacation time, yeah. And so, yeah, so for, you know, and we still we have trouble with everyone engaging in that, but we're kind of okay with that because we do a lot through our jobs and like we have goals to increase volunteerism. But sometimes people have there are times in life where you've got two young kids or you've got other things going on that we don't expect it consistently 100% of the time from everybody. Although you still do with two young kids, I'm sure. but you know, they're life circumstances, so we don't pressure anybody. But we definitely have more people volunteering these days. After setting a goal for it,
we've got a nice built space here, so we allow nonprofits to come in and kind of leverage our core competencies, which are kind of beer and gathering place. Mm-hmm. So we invite schools and various other organizations to come in, and we'll do a profit share. You know, one night we give them 20% of the gross profit for the night. We do that several times a month, and. Then we also started what we call Community Tap. The Community Tap is a program where we basically map out one charity per month that's kind of aligned with our core values, whether it's bike advocacy or water issues for river cleanup, Willamette River Keepers, stuff like that. And we'll give them 1% of in-house draft beer sales for the month. So, and what we've also tied into that is a really nice volunteer opportunity. So now, for the first time ever, we have 12 times a year, they were giving 1% to 12 different organizations, and there's also 12 different volunteer opportunities aligned with that. So it's really great to kind of put some context to it, because left to its own devices, the volunteer thing kind of just falls off the end of the conveyor belt. And now we can plan for it, and we can put the onus on the nonprofits that we're engaging. Like, you know, we're gonna give you this money, but in return, you need to help us engage our employees and do something meaningful for your organization. So I think the structure's been super helpful. But so yeah, just leveraging space and beer into helping raise money and awareness for nonprofits is kind of core, you know, for us.
I would, you know, just for people who are interested in the B Corp certification, it is, as a brewer, like Steve said, like really hard to get points in the community area. And the part of what they're evaluating is sourcing locally or locating in a low-income neighborhood. And those are things that, you know, we have very limited supply sources, and so, and if your brewery is already built, you can't really like move it into a low-income neighborhood. So there are certain things that are a little challenging for us. And I know our coworkers who like spend a lot of time focusing on the community aspect were like devastated when they saw that score that was like so low and below average. And so it took some like explaining, but just normalizing what you said, I guess, because there's a lot for in the B Corp language that falls under community, not just giving and engagement.
There's actually very little around giving and engagement.
Supply chain.
Yeah.
And that's part of when we do our the sustainability class with new hires, we try to do that around, you know, a month or two, so they're not quite new. They've absorbed some of the culture first, and then I think their brain is better able to take in this additional piece of information. But we talk about B Corp then, and we talk about LEED certification and all our goals and all of that, and I hope that, you know, they're listening and
how it ties in with your business.
And you know, we assume our restaurant's pretty big, that's most of our employees are in our restaurant, not in our brewery. So, you know, if a customer comes in and says to a server, what does it mean that you're a B Corp? Like, the last thing we want them to say is, I'm not sure, let me check on that. So our hope is, you know, to at least instill a beginning of knowledge. And that's what the class, the whole intent is, if someone asks you a more general, what does sustainability mean, they feel comfortable answering with at least a few points and they can see how it relates to their job.
We also have like a one pager that just said, because I found that kind of hard to communicate to coworkers, like what the heck is a B Corp? What does that mean for us? And how is that different than what we were already doing? But we have a one pager that I thought has been kind of helpful, where it just shows like, how did we get points in the environment? Like, it's because we do this. It's because we have renewable energy on site with our biogas and our solar. It's because we have a smaller gap between our highest paid employee and our lowest paid employee, and like pull out some of those questions that we're getting good points on, and like should like write out exactly what they see every day that's gaining points for us. But it's still a bit of a challenge, I would say, but getting better all the time. We actually have people now that are like interviewing with us, and they say like, I heard you're a B Corp, that's why I'm interviewing with you, and so they know that it's something. So, and then people that you would never expect, you know, so it's getting out for sure.
Super. Any other questions out there? I'm gonna make this the last question. I think we're running down on time, but so if I was a consumer in marketplace that maybe was not from Portlandia and didn't already feel a great affinity to sustainability, convince me why you as a sustainable brewer are a better option than the regular conventional person next to you on the shelf.
I go back to your point. I don't think we use it as like a differentiate, like a competitive. I mean, I don't know. It is, I guess, to some degree, but
beer tastes better when you feel good drinking it.
Yeah. That is what we tell people. Like, think about if you can step back out of, you know, I'm just buying this beer, and you think about like what all went into this beer, and if you're working in a brewery where you have medical benefits, you know, even if you're not required by law to do that, and you have retirement planning and you have the support structure and all of that, like how much better is that beer than the other one that doesn't have any of those aspects of treating employees well? And you know, this brewery comes from a place that, or the beer comes from a place that does give back to the community. And that's what, even like, I'll be talking to my sister-in-law the other day. She's like super into good companies and all of that, and I don't think it ever dawned on her to think about the employee side. So we're trying to maybe tell that story a little bit more, and understanding like that is our biggest asset, right? Like, our product is nothing without all the love and labor that our staff has put into it, and the experience they're giving to our customers, whether within our restaurant or outside, you know, doing sales. So focusing more on, like, yes, you're supporting a business that truly cares about its employees and what an impact that can make, and that has a ripple effect in the community, and other businesses see that and it works, because, you know, people don't leave our places. They stay, and we get the best people, and it's awesome.
When it definitely does come down to the beer. If the beer is not top notch, don't drink it. I don't care how wonderful the people or the practices are. If the beer is not wonderful, the beer is not wonderful. And we're living in such a wonderful time for beer, with breweries opening up every week, and there's so much variety, so much selection, so much quality out there right now. What I like to think, maybe a self-serving way to think, I guess, but you look at, I'll exclude myself for the moment, the beer that these three breweries make is absolutely excellent. And to me, when you look at what it means to be a B Corp, it's not just wanting to do better. It's striving for excellence. And my general sense is that, and you take this outside of the brewery realm, the companies that tend to focus the most on sustainability and the most on culture and the most on product quality, they're striving for excellence all around. And to me, you see a company that's a B Corp company, chances are they're striving for excellence, not just in sustainability, but in everything that they do. And to me, it's just a good indicator that the beer is probably going to be wonderful, or the product's going to be wonderful if it's outside of that. And that's a little bit of horn tooting for all B Corps out there. But I think it's an important one, because this is bigger than the core product, but the core product fuels the whole thing. And it really comes down to, you want to have the best possible beer, choose a company that's doing the best possible practices, because they probably are also doing the best possible practices when it comes to making that beer.
It's not an easy certification.
No.
So it makes it meaningful.
Yeah, I think I kind of encourage people to vote with their dollar. You know, you can vote every 4 years for a president, but the most powerful thing you can do in your daily life is to vote with your dollar. Vote for great products made by companies that give a shit and are doing it the right way. And it's okay to brag about, you know, your B Corp status, and in the hopes that you're going to excite some molecules in other companies. And they're going to be, first of all, they're going to, well, B is for beer? What is the benefit? Okay, so it just starts a dialogue. And all good things that happen in the world start with a little spark. And so voting with your dollar every day for something as simple as beer is really, really important. So it's up to us to tell that story on our packaging, our tap handle. We're challenged with very little real estate in the beer world. You got a little tap handle, yeah, and a little label that's very regulated by the federal government. You can't talk about nutritional benefits of organics and all this stuff because they are the strength or whatever. But you can certainly put the B Corp logo right on there and tell the story. And let them vote every day, everything they do with their dollar and their time. I think that's where you're going to win outside of politics, is just that daily interaction with great companies that are doing the right thing.
Awesome. Well, we're out of time. Really appreciate all of you taking time out of your busy schedule this week to come chat about sustainability with us. So give yourselves a hand. Thank you.